Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Oxygen, The Molecule That Made the World, by Nick Lane. Narrated by Nigel Patterson. Publisher's note. In this audio edition, you will hear references to figures present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Chapter 1. Introduction. Elixir of Life and Death. Oxygen defies easy classification. Ever since it was discovered in the 1770s, its properties and chemistry have been squabbled over by scholars and charlatans alike. The controversy persists today. Oxygen is hailed as the elixir of life, a wonder tonic, a cure for aging, a beauty treatment, and a potent medical therapy. It is also purported to be a fire hazard and a dangerous poison that will kill us in the end. The popular health press is contradictory. Inhaling pure oxygen in cosmopolitan oxygen bars and health clinics is said to work wonders, yet the opposite, high-altitude therapy, is claimed to eliminate superfluous oxygen, conferring the health benefits of austerity. So-called active oxygen treatments, meaning ozone and hydrogen peroxide, are touted as miraculous scourges of bacterial infection or as cures for cancer. Yet at the same time, we are told that the secret of a long life is to eat plenty of antioxidants to protect us against the very same active forms of oxygen. Oxygen seems to attract nonsense and misinformation like a magnet. However muddled these accounts, they agree about one thing: oxygen is important. After all, if we stop breathing it, we will be dead in minutes. Our bodies are beautifully designed to deliver oxygen to each of our 15 million million cells. All the symbolism of red blood ultimately rests in the simple chemical bonding between oxygen and hemoglobin in our red blood cells. Suffocation and drowning, the physical deprivation of oxygen, are among the darkest of human fears. If we think of a planet without oxygen, we think of a sterile place pockmarked with craters, a place like the Moon or Mars. The presence of oxygen in a planetary atmosphere is the litmus test of life. Water signals the potential for life, but oxygen is the sign of its fulfillment. Only life can produce free oxygen in the air in any abundance. If pressed for an unemotional reason for not cutting down the rainforests or polluting the oceans, we may argue that these great resources are the lungs of the world, ventilating the earth with life-giving oxygen. This is not true, as we shall hear, but illustrates the reverence in which we hold oxygen. Perhaps it is not entirely surprising that we seek mystical or healing properties in a colourless, odourless gas. This book is about life, death, and oxygen, about how and why life produced and adapted to oxygen, about the evolutionary past and future of life on Earth, about energy and health, disease and death, sex and regeneration, and about ourselves. Oxygen is important in ways that most of us hardly even begin to imagine, ways that are far more fascinating than the loud claims of health features. But before we begin our journey, we need to mark out the playing field. Is oxygen an elixir, or a poison, or both? And how can we tell the difference? The easiest way to find out is to go back in time, to the beginnings of our own understanding. Even the discovery of oxygen was controversial. Credit is usually split between the English clergyman and chemist Joseph Priestley, the Swedish apothecary Carl Scheele, and the French tax collector and father of modern chemistry Antoine Lavoisier. Scheele was the first of the three, but he put too much trust in the shifting sands of aristocratic patronage and floundered without publication for 6 years. Priestley had no such problems. In 1774, he made oxygen by focusing sunlight onto an oxide of mercury and was quick to write 3 volumes on the subject. Scheele and Priestley would have taken all the credit, except that neither grasped the full significance of the new gas. Both appreciated that burning was more vigorous in pure oxygen. Scheele even called it fire air. yet both thought of combustion in terms of an erroneous theory, the idea that an invisible substance known as phlogiston was released into the air during burning, rather than oxygen being taken up. They thought of oxygen as pure, dephlogisticated air, from which all the contaminating phlogiston had been removed. Lavoisier, the chemical revolutionary and political conservative, cast off this twisted theory in the years before the French Revolution. It was Lavoisier who bequeathed the name oxygen, and he who finally proved that oxygen was the reactive constituent of air. The name oxygen was derived from the Greek for acid former, in the mistaken belief that oxygen is necessary for the formation of all acids. It is necessary for some, such as sulfuric and nitric acids, but not for others, like hydrochloric acid. Combustion, said Lavoisier, was the reaction of oxygen with carbon or other substances. In a famous demonstration, he showed that the Holy Roman Emperor's diamonds, made of carbon, could be vaporized if heated in the presence of oxygen to form carbon dioxide, but that diamonds are impervious to heat if oxygen is excluded. Diamonds are forever only in the absence of oxygen. Lavoisier went further. By collecting gases and taking precise measurements with his ultra-sensitive balances, he showed that combustion and human respiration are fundamentally the same process. Both consume oxygen and materials containing carbon and hydrogen to give off carbon dioxide and water. Lavoisier was still engaged in weighing the gases emitted by breathing and perspiration when he was interrupted by the soldiers of the Revolutionary Tribunal, accompanied by an uncontrollable mob. He had made some powerful enemies, among them the revolutionary leader Jean-Paul Marat. Convicted on the ludicrous charge of watering the soldiers' tobacco and of appropriating revenues belonging to the state, Lavoisier was beheaded in May 1794. As the great mathematician Lagrange said, it took but a moment to cut off that head, though 100 years, perhaps, will be required to produce another like it. Curiously, this famous story of the discovery of oxygen is probably wrong. Not only did the alchemists get there first, but they also had a clear appreciation of the significance of oxygen. In 1604, 170 years before Scheele, Priestley and Lavoisier, the Polish alchemist Michael Sendivogius wrote that man was created of the earth and lives by virtue of the air, for there is in the air a secret food of life, whose invisible congealed spirit is better than the whole earth. Sendivogius proposed that this aerial food of life circulated between the air and earth by way of an unusual salt, nitre, or saltpeter. Nitre, potassium nitrate, KNO3, gives every appearance of condensing from the air as a white crust on well-manured soils containing nitrogen. It has some remarkable properties. Besides being a fine fertilizer, it was used for preserving meat and as a folk remedy. When added to drinks, nitre cools them down as effectively as ice, yet when taken as a medicine, produces a strong warming effect. The acid of nitre, aqua regia, or queen of waters, could dissolve gold, an attribute that appealed to alchemists. Nitre is also the chief component of gunpowder, which was invented by Chinese alchemists in the 9th century. When heated above 336 degrees Celsius, nitre decomposes to release oxygen, which the alchemists knew as aerial nitre. Sendivogius evidently believed he had discovered the elixir of life, without which no mortal can live, and without which nothing grows or is generated in the world. His ideas went beyond theory. Sendivogius almost certainly produced oxygen by heating nitre, and may well have explained his methods to the Dutch inventor and fellow alchemist Cornelius Drebbel, a lost hero of Renaissance science. Drebbel gave a brilliant demonstration of the practical utility of oxygen in 1621. After constructing a solar-powered perpetual motion machine and a variety of refrigerators and automata for King James I of England, Drebbel built the world's first submarine. King James, accompanied by thousands of his subjects, stood on the banks of the River Thames to watch its maiden voyage from Westminster to Greenwich, a distance of 10 miles. Manned by 12 oarsmen, the wooden submarine apparently stayed underwater for 3 hours. Much of the interest centred on how Drebbel had managed to refresh the air for the rowers during this time. According to eyewitness accounts, discussed some years later in 1660 by the great chemist Robert Boyle, Drebbel had used a bottle of liquor, others referred to it as a gas, to refresh the vital parts of the air. Drebbel conceived that it is not the whole body of the air, but a certain quintessence or spirituous part of it that makes it fit for respiration, which, being spent, the remaining grosser body, or carcass, if I may so call it, of the air, is unable to cherish the vital flame residing in the heart. For when, from time to time, he, Drebbel, perceived the finer and purer part of the air was consumed, he would, by unstopping a vessel full of this liquor, speedily restore to the troubled air such a proportion of vital parts as would make it again, for a good while, fit for respiration. Presumably, Drebbel had succeeded in bottling oxygen gas, following the instructions of his mentor Sendivogius, by heating nitre. Sendivogius, Drebbel, and Boyle clearly thought of the air as a mixture of gases, one of which was the vital gas oxygen. They recognised that in confined spaces the air was depleted of oxygen by breathing or burning. Boyle certainly saw respiration and combustion in similar terms, the vital flame residing in the heart, even if he did not appreciate how exactly analogous the two reactions really were. Boyle's contemporary and fellow of the Royal Society, John Mayo, went even further. He showed that aerial nitre, oxygen, when breathed into the lungs, gave arterial blood its red colour. Aerial nitre, he said, was a normal constituent of the air, from where it becomes food for fires and also passes into the blood of animals by respiration. It is not to be supposed that the air itself, but only its more active and subtle part, is the igneo-aerial food. In other words, despite his archaic vocabulary, Mayo had a strikingly modern concept of oxygen as early as 1674. Against this background, Priestley's attachment to the phlogiston theory, the idea that burning releases an invisible substance, a century later, looks almost comical, although he was by no means alone. Guided by false phlogiston, the study of airs had been groping at shadows for the best part of a century. To account for experimental results, phlogiston was assigned a positive weight, no weight at all, or a negative weight, depending on the requirements. Even those who credit Priestley with the discovery of oxygen accept that his adherence to this theory blinded him to the true meaning of his discovery. To be fair to Priestley, he was perfectly aware of the problems with the phlogiston theory. He compared phlogiston with light and heat, which could not be weighed either then as now. In another sense, though, Priestley was uncannily prescient. He foresaw not only the medical applications of oxygen, which he persisted in calling dephlogisticated air, but also its potential danger. In his Experiments and Observations on Different Kinds of Air, published in 1775, Priestley mused on his own experiences of breathing pure oxygen. The feeling of it to my lungs was not sensibly different from that of common air, but I fancied that my breast felt peculiarly light and easy for some time afterwards. Who can tell but that in time this pure air may become a fashionable article in luxury? From the greater strength and vivacity of the flame of a candle in this pure air, it may be conjectured that it might be peculiarly salutary to the lungs in certain morbid cases, when the common air would not be sufficient to carry off the putrid effluvium fast enough. But perhaps we may also infer from these experiments that though pure dephlogisticated air, oxygen, might be very useful as a medicine, it might not be so proper for us in the usual healthy state of the body. For as a candle burns out much faster in dephlogisticated than in common air, so we might, as may be said, live out too fast, and the animal powers be too soon exhausted in this kind of pure air. A moralist, at least, may say that the air which nature has provided for us is as good as we deserve. Anyone inhaling pure oxygen in an oxygen bar today might smile at Priestley's quaint analogy and moral sentiments, but few researchers would disagree with the substance of these remarks. Strikingly, Priestley's words contain the first suggestion, to my knowledge, that oxygen might accelerate aging. This caution was lost on his contemporaries, who went on to embrace the medical potential of oxygen before the end of that century. Despite suspicions, its toxicity was not documented for a further 100 years. The first person to use pure oxygen therapeutically, on a large scale at least, was Thomas Beddoes. Beddoes founded the Pneumatic Institute for Inhalational Gas Therapy in Bristol in 1798, in which he employed the brilliant young chemist Humphrey Davy. The pair aimed to treat diseases hitherto found incurable. Unfortunately, they were overly ambitious in their choice of patients, and their treatments offered little clinical benefit. Worse, impurities in the gas frequently caused inflammation of the lungs. Ironically, the inflammation may not have been caused only by impurities. Pure oxygen also inflames the lungs. Faced with these problems, as well as unreliable supplies of oxygen, the Institute closed its doors in 1802. Davy later described his work there as the dreams of misemployed genius, which the light of experiment and observation has never conducted to truth. This pattern of hopes and failures persisted throughout much of the 19th century. Problems with impurities and diverse methods of delivery to the patient meant that a clinical consensus never emerged. Sometimes oxygen was inhaled directly from a mask or bag. In other cases, the gas was bubbled through a bucket of water placed near the bed, and the air of the room fanned towards the patient. Failure must have been assured. With such disparate procedures and little in the way of systematic comparisons, it is hardly surprising that outcomes were discrepant. Advocates of oxygen therapy claimed miraculous cures, which may have been true in conditions such as pneumonia, but the voices of mainstream medicine were for the most part unimpressed, arguing that any perceived benefits were transitory, palliative, or imaginary. The gap was forced even wider by the usual quacks and charlatans, who peddled a secret preparation known as compound oxygen to a gullible public. Some claims made in the 1880s were remarkably similar to those made today by proponents of active oxygen therapies. They were dismissed then, as today, by ethical practitioners of oxygen therapies. Medical interest in oxygen therapies picked up after a number of anecdotal reports suggested that higher oxygen pressures really did affect health. For example, patients with pneumonia living at high altitude in cities like Mexico City, where the oxygen pressure is low, were found to have a better chance of recovery if rushed down to the plains, where oxygen pressure is higher. Similarly, patients with cardiovascular disease generally fared better at sea level than at high altitude. Impressed by these reports, the American physician Orville Cunningham reasoned that still higher barometric pressures might amplify the effect. Following a number of apparent successes, a grateful client helped finance construction of the largest ever hyperbaric chamber in Cleveland, Ohio, in 1928. $1 million hollow steel ball, 20 metres, 65 feet in diameter, and 5 stories tall, pressurised to about twice the atmospheric pressure at sea level. Cunningham fitted out his giant steel ball as a hotel, with a smoking lounge, restaurant, rich carpeting, and private rooms. Unfortunately, he used compressed air, not oxygen, so the total oxygen pressure was no higher than could have been achieved with a mask, at a fraction of the cost. Worse, rather than treating people with conditions such as pneumonia and cardiovascular disease who might have benefited, he overstepped the mark by treating patients with diabetes, pernicious anemia, and cancer, on the fallacious grounds that all these conditions were caused by anaerobic, oxygen-hating bacteria. Both his objectives and his results failed to impress the American Medical Association, who condemned the scheme as tinctured much more strongly with economics than with scientific medicine. The steel ball lasted but a few years before being dismantled and sold for scrap in 1942, contributing to the American war effort. Cunningham should have known better. Despite the equivocal history of oxygen therapy, the field had finally been put on a scientific footing by the distinguished Scottish physiologist John Scott Haldane, father of the biologist J.B.S. Haldane, in the early years of the 20th century. Haldane was an expert in diving medicine and had spent the First World War using oxygen to treat injuries caused by chlorine gas. He summed up his experiences in the groundbreaking book Respiration, published in 1922, in which he argued that some patients with respiratory, circulatory, and infectious conditions could be cured by continuous oxygen inhalation. Given properly, he said, oxygen therapy was not just palliative, but could break the vicious cycle of degeneration, giving the body an opportunity to recover its own healthy equilibrium. Haldane's tenets underpin modern oxygen therapies, yet even today we do not have a clear appreciation of how beneficial these therapies can be. A large clinical trial, reported in the prestigious New England Journal of Medicine in January 2000, showed that inhalation of 80% oxygen for 2 hours halved the risk of wound infection after colorectal surgery, compared with routine practice, 30% oxygen for 2 hours. The finding that a simple treatment can make a big difference is encouraging, but the fact that a treatment available in essentially the same form for 200 years can still make medical headlines at the start of the 21st century is salutary. If nothing else, it illustrates just how far the progress of science can be impeded by a professional knee-jerk response to the inflated claims of quacks and charlatans. Another reason for caution was spelled out by Haldane early in the 20th century, the possibility of oxygen toxicity. Haldane himself had written that the probable risks of prolonged administration of pure oxygen must be borne in mind, and, if necessary, balanced against the risks of allowing the oxygen want to continue. No fixed rule can be given. The proper course to pursue must be determined by the physician after careful observation of the patient, and in the light of experience and knowledge. It is understandable that physicians prefer to err on the side of caution, but what are these risks? Haldane's careful wording makes them sound a little theoretical, but oxygen, especially under pressure, can cause shockingly physical reactions, as Haldane knew well from his own research in diving medicine. The toxicity of oxygen is slow-acting or hidden from view in normal circumstances. Many people receive oxygen therapy in hospital or spend days, sometimes weeks, in oxygen tents or inhale oxygen in bars with no ill effects. Astronauts often breathe pure oxygen for weeks on end, though in space the capsule is pressurized to only 1/3 of atmospheric pressure, which makes it equivalent to breathing 33% oxygen. The difference that pressure makes to the oxygen concentration in the atmosphere explains why 3 astronauts died when Apollo 1 caught fire in 1967 as they were completing tests on the ground. In space, the inside of the capsule is always pressurized to a higher pressure than the surrounding vacuum, which means that spacecraft are built to withstand a greater pressure inside than outside. To maintain this pressure differential, Apollo 1 was pressurized to above atmospheric pressure while on the ground. Unfortunately, the spacecraft was still being ventilated with pure oxygen. This meant that instead of an atmosphere equivalent to 33% oxygen, the astronauts were actually breathing the equivalent of 130% oxygen. In this oxygen-rich atmosphere, a spark from the electrical wiring led to an uncontrollable fire, which reached a temperature of 2,500 degrees Celsius within minutes. But oxygen is more than just a fire risk. It is toxic to breathe. This toxicity depends on the concentration and duration of exposure. Most people can breathe pure oxygen for a day or two, but we cannot breathe it for longer without risk. If the concentration of oxygen is increased even more by compressing the gas, then the toxic effects become dramatic. The realization that oxygen is toxic came from the experiences of the earliest scuba divers towards the end of the 19th century. The word scuba was a later coinage and stands for self-contained underwater breathing apparatus. Scuba divers were vulnerable because they carried their breathing apparatus with them and usually breathed pure oxygen. The oxygen in the apparatus could be compressed by water pressure. Breathing pure oxygen at depths below about 8 metres, 26 feet, causes seizures similar to an epileptic grand mal, a disaster if the diver loses consciousness underwater. Oxygen convulsions were first described systematically by the French physiologist Paul Bert, professor of physiology at the Sorbonne in Paris. In his celebrated 1878 monograph on barometric pressure, Bert discussed the effect of oxygen on animals subjected to different pressures in a hyperbaric chamber. Very high oxygen concentrations caused convulsions and death in a matter of minutes. The following decade, in 1899, the Scottish pathologist James Lorraine Smith showed that lower levels of oxygen could have an equally deadly but delayed effect. Animals exposed to 75% oxygen or more at normal air pressure had such serious inflammation of the lungs after a few days that they died. For this reason, oxygen dosages in hospitals are always strictly controlled. Convulsions and lung injury became familiar worries to scuba divers, however. Both Paul Bert and James Lorraine Smith are still commemorated in diving terminology. Unfortunately for Smith, his unusual name, along with his habit of styling himself J. Lorraine Smith, frequently turns the tribute into the Lorraine Smith effect. While many divers were careful not to dive too deep while breathing pure oxygen, the Navy could not always afford to be so cautious. In the British Royal Navy Submarine Escape Handbook, published in 1942, seamen were instructed to watch out for the symptoms of oxygen poisoning. Tingling of the fingers and toes, and twitching of the muscles, especially around the mouth. Convulsions followed by unconsciousness and death if a remedy is not taken. Naval divers during the war invented a mythical monster, Oxygen Pete, who lurked at the bottom of the sea, waiting to molest unwary divers. Oxygen toxicity hits during this time were referred to as getting a peat. A more rigorous understanding of oxygen toxicity, human limits, and gas mixtures was clearly needed, and J.B.S. Haldane was commissioned by the Royal Navy to follow in the footsteps of his father. Always an advocate of being one's own rabbit, Haldane subjected himself and his colleagues to various oxygen concentrations under different pressures, noting how long it took before convulsions set in. In a celebrated essay on self-experimentation, On Being One's Own Rabbit, published in 1928, Haldane wrote that, "To do the sort of things to a dog that one does to the average medical student requires a license signed in triplicate by two archbishops." He also thought it peculiar that so few chemists wondered what it actually felt like to become more acid or alkaline or dilute. Exposure to pure oxygen at 7 atmospheres pressure led to convulsions within 5 minutes. He later wrote that, "The convulsions are very violent, and in my own case, the injury caused to my back is still painful after a year. They last for about 2 minutes and are followed by flaccidity. I wake in a state of extreme terror, in which I may make futile attempts to escape from the steel chamber." Nonetheless, his efforts were successful. The Royal Navy secretly developed various nitrogen-oxygen nitrox mixtures, which lowered the risk of both oxygen toxicity and nitrogen narcosis, the bends. These nitrox mixtures were used by British commandos defending Gibraltar in the Second World War, and were kept such a close secret that even the US Navy did not find out until the 1950s. Using nitrox mixtures, the British divers could operate at greater depths. A major element of British strategy was to lure the combatants into deep waters until they were overwhelmed by convulsions, mugged by oxygen, perfidious Albion indeed. Breathing oxygen at high concentration is obviously toxic. Above about 2 atmospheres of pressure, pure oxygen causes convulsions and sometimes death. Oxygen accounts for about 1/5 of atmospheric pressure, so pure oxygen at 2 atmospheres pressure is 10 times our normal exposure. At lower concentrations, oxygen is unlikely to cause convulsions, but breathing pure oxygen at normal atmospheric pressure, 5 times our normal exposure, for a few days, can still cause life-threatening lung damage. Such serious inflammation of the lungs prevents us from breathing properly. Ironically, we then cannot pass oxygen into the bloodstream, so we actually die from oxygen starvation to the rest of the body. At lower levels of oxygen, 40 or 50% oxygen, or about twice our normal exposure, the lungs can normally withstand injury and continue to function, though they may become damaged in the end. In these circumstances, the rest of the body adapts by slowing down the heartbeat and producing fewer red blood cells. These adaptations are the opposite of the changes that take place to oxygen deprivation at high altitudes. The result, in both cases, is that the tissues receive the same amount of oxygen as before, no more nor less. Such adaptations illustrate the importance of unchanging oxygen levels in the body. They also mean that we cannot gain any long-term benefit from either high or low levels of oxygen, except when we are sick and pathologically oxygen deprived. Athletes training at altitude must come down to sea level and race within days or weeks, or else the benefits are lost. When we train at altitude, we generate more red blood cells to absorb extra oxygen from the thin air. When we return to sea level, we adapt back to the higher levels of oxygen by producing fewer red blood cells. The benefits never outlast the adaptation. I imagine that most people are comfortable with the idea that too much oxygen can be bad, in effect, that it is possible to have too much of a good thing. Similarly, there is nothing challenging about the idea that we respond to moderate perturbations by re-establishing the physiological status quo. It is a very different proposition to say that 21% oxygen is toxic and will kill us in the end. This is as much as to say that, despite millions of years of evolution, we still cannot adapt to the concentration of oxygen that nature has provided for us. This statement is counterintuitive, to say the least, yet it is the basis of the so-called free radical theory of aging. In essence, this theory argues that aging, and so death, is caused by breathing oxygen over a lifetime. Oxygen is thus not only necessary for life, but is also the primary cause of aging and death. Many people have heard of free radicals, even if they have only a hazy idea of what they actually are. Most free radicals of biological importance are simply reactive forms of molecular oxygen, which can damage biological molecules. We will consider them in detail in Chapter 6. Regardless of whether oxygen causes convulsions and sudden death, or slow lung damage, or ultra-slow aging, it always acts in exactly the same way. All forms of oxygen toxicity are caused by the formation of free radicals from oxygen. As the great 16th century alchemist Paracelsus said, the poison is in the dose. Convulsions are caused by a massive excess of free radicals acting on the brain, lung damage by a smaller excess acting on the lungs. But free radicals are not just toxic. Fire is impossible without free radicals. So too is photosynthesis or respiration. When we use oxygen to extract energy from food, we have to produce free radical intermediates. The secret to all the chemistry of oxygen, whether we think of it as good or bad, is the formation of free radicals. As conventionally stated, the idea that breathing oxygen causes aging is disarmingly simple. We produce free radicals continuously inside every cell of our body as the cells respire. Most of these are mopped up by antioxidant defences, which neutralise their effects. The trouble is that our defences are not perfect. A proportion of free radicals slip through the net, and these can damage vital components of cells and tissues, such as DNA and proteins. Over a lifetime, the damage gradually accumulates until it finally overwhelms the ability of the body to maintain its integrity. This gradual deterioration is known as aging. According to this conventional, if simplistic, explanation, the more antioxidants we eat, the more we can protect ourselves against damage from free radicals. This is why fruit and vegetables are good for us. They contain lots of antioxidants. Nowadays, many people supplement their diet with potent antioxidants, in the belief that their diet cannot provide an adequate supply. The implication is that if we eat enough of the right kind of antioxidants, we can postpone aging and the diseases of old age indefinitely. This has been touted as the antioxidant miracle. The truth is rather more complicated, but far more interesting. I shall argue that oxygen-free radicals do cause aging, but that the implications are almost exactly the opposite of what we might expect. We will never extend our lives significantly to 150 or 200 by loading ourselves with even the most potent antioxidant supplements. On the contrary, antioxidant supplements might actually make us more vulnerable to some diseases. Antioxidants are bit players in the large cast of adaptations that life has made to the presence of oxygen in the air. We can only understand their role if we consider them in the context of the play as a whole. The response of life to the threats and the possibilities of oxygen include adaptations that have had the most profound consequences. Let's just consider a few examples. Take photosynthesis, the formation of organic matter by plants, algae, and some bacteria using the energy of sunlight, which today supports almost all life on Earth. It is probable that photosynthesis, which generates oxygen as a waste product, could only have evolved because life had already adapted to provide itself with defenses against the oxygen-free radicals produced by ultraviolet radiation in the environment. This may explain why life took off on Earth but never did on Mars. Take the abundance of large animals and plants characteristic of our world. The first multicellular organisms probably evolved from clumps of cells which clustered together to deal collectively with the rising tide of atmospheric oxygen produced by photosynthesis. Without the threat of oxygen toxicity, life would never have advanced beyond a green slime. Even gigantism relates to oxygen. Giant size offers an escape from the threat of oxygen, as metabolic rate is slower in very large animals, and explains the evolution of monster dragonflies with a wingspan as broad as a seagull, and possibly the rise and fall of the dinosaurs. Think about the sexes. Why should there be only two sexes? Why not one, or three, or many? The evolution of two sexes may have been a way of coping with oxygen. We shall hear that babies can only be born young if they are born of two sexes, otherwise oxygen causes the birth of degenerate offspring, destined to age prematurely. This may explain why cloned animals tend to die young. Dolly the sheep, for example, already has arthritis at the age of 5, betraying a real age of 11. Finally, think of powered flight. Birds and bats have exceptionally long lives for their sizes. Why? Flying demands metabolic adaptations to oxygen that also confer a long lifespan. If we want to extend our own lifespan, we must look to the birds. These are grand statements, which I shall explain and defend later in the book. They are all part of our journey to find out how oxygen affects our own lives and deaths. This is unashamedly a book about science. It is not a catalogue of dry facts about how the world works. Rather, like science itself, it is full of quirks, experiments, oddities, speculations, hypotheses, and predictions. Science is often presented as the facts, frequently in short sound bites. The scientific method is described as a methodical unravelling of the truth, which, if this were true, would bore most people, including most scientists, to tears. The impression that science gives access to an objective reality, as opposed to the subjective world of ethics, sets it up in opposition to religion as an ethical system, and gives scientists an air of preaching. In fact, science gives vivid insights into the workings of nature, but falls short of objective reality. Too often, scientific facts turn out to be wrong or misleading. We are told that there is no risk of a Frankensteinian disaster, only to see it come true before our eyes. At other times, scientists squabble about the meaning of obscure research findings, discrediting their colleagues in public. It is hardly surprising that the general public views science and scientists with growing scepticism. Apart from the unfortunate schism this opens up in society, it means that fewer young people dream of becoming scientists. This is a tragedy. I wonder if the tragedy might be averted to some extent if people had a better idea of the workings of science, of the fun, creativity, and adventure. The real interest of science lies in the unknown, the excitement of charting new terrain. Poking around in the unknown rarely generates a perfect picture of the world. We are more likely to construct a kind of medieval map, a distorted but recognizable picture of reality. Scientists try to link together the contours of a story through experiments that fill in a detail here or there. Much of the joy of science lies in devising and interpreting experiments that test these hypothetical landscapes. I have therefore been careful to explain the experiments and observations that underpin the story of this book. I have tried to show how it is that science can be interpreted in different ways, and I have presented the evidence itself, along with its flaws, so that you may judge for yourself whether my own interpretation is convincing. I hope this approach will help you to share the spirit of adventure along the border of the known and the unknown. Science, then, generates hypotheses based on evidence that is specific but limited in scope, islands of knowledge in a sea of unknowing. Very often, individual results only make sense when seen in the context of a bigger picture. All scientific papers have a discussion section, whose purpose is to place the new results in perspective. But science is nowadays highly specialized. It is rare for a medical researcher to refer to the studies of geologists and paleontologists in the discussion, or for a chemist to be much concerned with evolutionary theory. For most of the time, this matters little, but in the case of oxygen, perspective is obliterated by too confined a view. In this case, geology and chemistry have a great deal to say on evolutionary theory, and paleontology and animal behaviour have much to contribute to medical science. All these fields offer insight into our own lives and deaths. If an understanding of oxygen's role in life and death requires a multidisciplinary approach, it also offers fresh perspectives on each of these fields. Looking at evolution and health through the prism of oxygen solves some long-standing conundrums. I have already mentioned one example, the evolution of two sexes. If we start with the dilemma itself, why did two sexes evolve? It is difficult to discriminate between one hypothesis and another. We can't even eliminate the possibility that things just happened that way. Thinking about the role of oxygen in aging may seem to be irrelevant to this problem, but it actually forces us to conclude that two sexes are necessary for reproduction if a species produces motile sex cells that must search for a mate, and it generates a number of predictions. Thinking about life in this way also explains why we cannot extend our lives just by taking antioxidant supplements, and points us to more realistic ways of postponing aging and the ailments of old age. Oxygen thus acts as a magnifying glass, enabling us to scrutinize life from some unusual angles. That means that this book is about life, death, and oxygen, and not just about oxygen. I have tried to write for a wide audience who may have little knowledge of science and hope to be accessible to anyone prepared to make a little effort. The argument works out over the book as a whole, and you'll have to listen to the end to get the full story. Each chapter, however, tells a story of its own, and I have not assumed much prior knowledge from previous chapters. We shall hear that life's adaptations to oxygen, which began nearly 4,000,000,000 years ago, are still written in our innermost constitution. We shall hear that radiation poisoning, nuclear reactors, Noah's flood, photosynthesis, snowball earths, giant insects, predatory monsters, Food, sex, stress, and infectious diseases are all linked by oxygen. We shall hear that an oxygen-centric view gives striking insights into the nature of aging, disease, and death. We shall hear that oxygen, a simple, colourless, odourless gas, made the world in which we live, framing our own passage across the stage. We shall hear all this by thinking about how and why oxygen has influenced the evolution of life from the very beginning. Chapter 2. In the Beginning. The Origins and Importance of Oxygen. In the beginning, there was no oxygen. 4 billion years ago, the air probably contained about one part in a million of oxygen. Today, the atmosphere is just less than 21% oxygen, or 208,500 parts per million. However this change might have come about, it is pollution without parallel in the history of life on Earth. We do not think of it as pollution because for us, oxygen is necessary and life-giving. For the tiny single-celled organisms that lived on the early Earth, however, oxygen was anything but life-giving. It was a poison that could kill, even at trace levels. A lot of oxygen-hating organisms still exist, living in stagnant swamps or beneath the seabed, even in our own guts. Many of these die if exposed to an oxygen level above 0.1% of present atmospheric levels. For their ancestors, who ruled the ancient world, pollution with oxygen must have been calamitous. From dominating the world, they shrank back to a reclusive existence at the margins. Oxygen-hating organisms are said to be anaerobic. They cannot use oxygen, and in many cases can only live in its absence. Their problem is that they have nothing to protect them against oxygen poisoning. They possess few, if any, antioxidants. In contrast, most living things today tolerate so much oxygen in the air because they are stuffed full of antioxidants. There is a paradox hidden in this progression. How did modern organisms evolve their antioxidant protection? According to the standard textbook view, antioxidants could not have been present in the first cells that began emitting oxygen as a toxic waste product. How could they have adapted to a gas that had not existed before? Yet if this assumption is true, that antioxidants evolved after the rise in atmospheric oxygen, then the huge rise in atmospheric oxygen must have posed a very serious challenge to early life. If oxygen had anything like the effect on the first anaerobic cells that it does on their descendants today, then there ought to have been a mass extinction of anaerobic organisms that would put the fall of the dinosaurs in the shade. Why should we care? According to the free radical theory of aging discussed in Chapter 1, oxygen toxicity sets limits on our lives. If this is true, the ways in which life has adapted to oxygen over evolutionary time should be revealing. Did the rise in atmospheric oxygen really cause a mass extinction? How did life adapt? If aging and death are caused by an ultimate failure to adapt, can we learn anything from how the survivors of this putative Holocaust coped? Can we somehow do more of whatever they did? In the next few chapters, we will attempt to answer some of these questions by charting the response of organisms to changing oxygen levels over the eons. The origins and early history of life have attracted renewed research interest in the past few decades. Some of our most basic ideas about the genesis of life have been turned on their heads. Yet so persuasive and ingrained was the old view that even recent biology textbooks cling to its tenets. Many scientists working in other fields seem oblivious to the rewriting of their gospels. The old story is worth recounting here because the role ascribed to oxygen emphasizes its toxicity. In the 1920s, J.B.S. Haldane in England and Alexander Aparin in Russia independently began to think about the possible composition of the Earth's original atmosphere on the basis of gases known to be present in the atmosphere of Jupiter, which could be detected by their optical spectra. Haldane and Aparin argued that if the Earth condensed from a cloud of gas and dust, along with Jupiter and all the other planets, then the original atmosphere of the Earth ought to have contained a similarly noxious mixture of hydrogen, methane, and ammonia. Their ideas stood the test of time, and formed the basis of a famous series of experiments by Stanley Miller and Harold Urey in the United States during the 1950s. Miller and Urey passed electric sparks, simulating lightning, through a gaseous atmosphere comprising the three Jupiter gases and collected the end products. They found a complex mixture of organic compounds, including a high proportion of amino acids, from which all living things make proteins, the building blocks of life. Such reactions, they said, could have turned the early oceans into a thin organic soup containing all the precursors of life. The only other ingredients needed for life to congeal out of this soup were chance and time, both of which seemed to be virtually limitless. The planet is 4.5 billion years old, and the first fossils of large animals date from 500 million years ago. 4 billion years should have been long enough. The choice of the gases to work with made good practical as well as theoretical sense. Hydrogen, methane, and ammonia do not last long in the presence of oxygen and light. The mixture becomes oxidized, and when this happens, the yield of organic compounds quickly falls off. Chemically speaking, oxidation refers to the removal of electrons from an atom or molecule. The reverse process is called reduction, which involves the addition of electrons. Oxidation is named after oxygen, which is good at stripping electrons from molecules. To help you remember, think of oxygen as being caustic or destructive, like a paint stripper. Oxidation strips off the electron paint, whereas reduction has the blanketing effect of a fresh coat of paint. There is also an old mnemonic. Leo the lion says "Grr." Loss of electrons is oxidation, gain of electrons is reduction. The point is that oxygen can strip organic molecules of electrons, often shredding the molecules, which give up their own electrons as a sacrificial offering, in the process. Today, cells counter this kind of damage with antioxidants, but in the beginning there were no antioxidants. Free oxygen would have been an insurmountable problem, because any organic molecules, or incipient forms of life, would have been shredded if much oxygen was present. The fact that life did start can only mean that oxygen was not present in any abundance. The first cells then presumably evolved in an oxygen-free atmosphere, and in turn must have generated energy without the aid of oxygen. This seemed a reasonable proposal, as at the close of the 19th century, Louis Pasteur had described fermentation as life without oxygen, and subsequent research had proved him right. Because yeasts and many other single-celled organisms depend on fermentation for their energy and are simple in structure, it was an easy extrapolation to assume that they were relics of ancient life. This single-celled life must have lived by fermenting organic compounds dissolved in the oceans, the theory went, until they were superseded by the evolution of the first oxygen-evolving photosynthetic bacteria, the cyanobacteria, once, inaccurately but poetically, called the blue-green algae. The cyanobacteria learnt to harness the energy of the sun. Microscopic they may have been, but as the eons ticked away, inconceivably large numbers of cyanobacteria, several billion fit in a droplet of water, silently polluted their environment with toxic oxygen waste. To begin with, this oxygen would have reacted with minerals dissolved in the oceans or eroded from the rocks, oxidizing them and locking up the oxygen in mineral compounds. These enormous natural resources acted as a buffer against free oxygen for hundreds of millions of years. In the end, however, the buffer became completely oxidized. With nothing left to take up the slack, the atmosphere and oceans became abruptly, in geological terms, contaminated with excess oxygen. The cost was terrible, an oxygen holocaust. Here is Lynn Margulis, distinguished professor of biology at the University of Massachusetts, Amherst, writing in 1986. This was by far the greatest crisis the Earth has ever endured. Many kinds of microbes were immediately wiped out. Microbial life had no defense against this cataclysm, except the standard way of DNA replication and duplication, gene transfer and mutation. From multiple deaths and an enhanced bacterial sexuality that is characteristic of bacteria exposed to toxins, came a reorganization of the superorganism we call the microcosm. The newly resistant bacteria multiplied and quickly replaced those sensitive to oxygen on the Earth's surface as other bacteria survived beneath them in the anaerobic layers of mud and soil. From a holocaust that rivals the nuclear one we fear today came one of the most spectacular and important revolutions in the history of life. According to this view, the success of the New World Order stemmed not just from the ability of microorganisms to withstand oxygen toxicity, but from a stunning evolutionary tour de force in which cells became dependent on the very substance that had been a deadly poison. The inhabitants of this brave new world were energized by oxygen. The old theory continues, our dependency on oxygen obscures the fact that it is a toxic gas intimately linked with aging and death, to say nothing of being a serious fire risk. Over evolutionary time, the reactivity of oxygen has served to modulate its own accumulation in the atmosphere. We are told that ever since the explosion of multicellular life some 550 million years ago, atmospheric oxygen has hovered around 21%, the outcome of a sustainable natural balance. If its concentration strays too high, then oxygen toxicity suppresses plant growth. As a result, the amount of oxygen produced by photosynthesis falls, and this lowers atmospheric levels again. In an atmosphere with more than about 25% oxygen, we are told, even wet rainforests would flare up in vast conflagrations. Conversely, if oxygen levels were to fall below about 15%, animals would suffocate, and even dry twigs would fail to light. The continuous record of fossil charcoal in sedimentary rocks over the past 350 million years suggests that fires have continuously swept the Earth. If so, then oxygen levels could never have fallen below 15%. Thus, the biosphere has regulated atmospheric oxygen at a level congenial to itself throughout the modern age of plants and animals. This is the story I grew up with, and much of it is still widely accepted, or at least unquestioned. Although based on somewhat limited evidence, most of the claims sound biologically plausible. To summarise, life evolved through chemical evolution in a primordial soup, formed from a planetary atmosphere containing methane, ammonia, and hydrogen. The first cells fermented this soup until they were displaced by cyanobacteria, which used solar energy to power photosynthesis, giving off oxygen as a toxic waste product. This poisonous gas oxidized the rocks and oceans, and finally accumulated in the atmosphere, causing an apocalyptic extinction, an oxygen holocaust. From the ashes, a new world order emerged, which depended on the very gas that had wiped out most of its ancestors. The new order was energized by oxygen. Even so, the toxicity and reactivity of oxygen constrained the biosphere to regulate its atmospheric content at 21%. So firmly entrenched was this story in my own mind that I was exasperated to hear a claim on television that oxygen levels once reached 35% during the Carboniferous period, around 300 million years ago. Nonsense, I thought. Everything would burn. Plants wouldn't grow. I was not alone. The idea, although advanced seriously by geochemists of international standing, had at first been derided by the wider geological and biological communities. It was not until I began to research the subject that I became convinced that the revisionists were right. Many of the ideas are still controversial, and most of the individual pieces of evidence are flawed, but they have one redeeming feature. In the last two decades, we have stepped from the realms of geopoetry into a new era of molecular evidence, which underpins the new models of global change. Taken together, I find the weight of evidence convincing, even if the new story flies in the face of oxygen toxicity, and indeed sometimes common sense. Before examining the evidence and asking how it affects the lives we lead today, we should reorientate ourselves to the emerging picture. Almost every step of my previous summary has been reversed. Far from coalescing from a primordial soup, the new story goes, life might have begun in hot sulphurous vents known as black smokers, deep in the mid-ocean trenches. Paradoxically, the last common ancestor of all known life, tenderly known as Luca, the last universal common ancestor, is thought to have used trace amounts of oxygen to respire, even before her descendants learnt to photosynthesize, at least to generate oxygen. Instead of muddling along by fermentation, the first cells are thought to have extracted energy from a range of inorganic elements and compounds, including nitrate, nitrite, sulfate and sulfite, and oxygen. If so, Luca was already resistant to oxygen toxicity before there was any free oxygen in the air. Presumably, her descendants, such as the cyanobacteria, were similarly protected against their own waste product, and so did not succumb to an oxygen holocaust. In fact, there is no solid evidence that oxygen ever caused a mass extinction. Instead of rising swiftly to reach an equilibrium controlled by the biosphere, the oxygenation of the Earth seems to have proceeded in a series of sharp jerks or pulses, each one precipitated by non-biological factors such as plate tectonics and glaciation. Each rise in atmospheric oxygen has been linked with prolific biological radiations, in which life expanded to fill vacant ecological niches, in much the same way that the empty prairies propelled the colonization of the American West. An injection of oxygen into the air immediately preceded the rise of single-celled eukaryotes, cells containing a nucleus, which are the cellular ancestors of all multicellular organisms, including ourselves. Similar oxygen injections preceded the explosion of multicellular plants and animals at the beginning of the Cambrian period, which began 543 million years ago, and the evolution of giant insects and plants during the Carboniferous and early Permian, 320 to 270 million years ago. Perhaps even the rise of the dinosaurs. Conversely, several mass extinctions are associated with periods of falling oxygen levels, including the mother of all extinctions at the end of the Permian, around 250 million years ago. The inescapable conclusion that oxygen is a good thing may give few people a sleepless night, but will certainly help constrain our ideas of oxygen toxicity in aging and disease. The first sacred cow to be sacrificed was the Jupiter-like composition of Earth's primordial atmosphere. In fact, life must have evolved under an atmosphere that contained very little methane, hydrogen, or ammonia. The evidence for this is direct and comes from geology. The Earth and the Moon were formed just over 4.5 billion years ago. The age of the craters on the Moon, dated from rock samples brought back by the Apollo astronauts, suggests that our planetary system was bombarded by meteorites for at least 500 million years. The bombardment ended around 3.8 to 4 billion years ago. The oldest sedimentary rocks on Earth, which were laid down along what is now the west coast of Greenland, have been reliably dated to an age of 3.85 billion years, a mere 700 million years after the formation of the Earth, and certainly not long after the end of the bombardment. Despite their antiquity, these ancient rocks speak of an atmosphere and a hydrological cycle surprisingly similar to our own. The fact that these rocks were once sediments implies that they were laid down under a large body of water. The sediments were presumably eroded by rainwater from a landmass. This constrains the possible temperatures to within a range compatible with evaporation, cloud formation, and precipitation. The mineral content of the rocks allows an informed guess about the composition of the air at the time. There are carbonates present, which probably formed from carbon dioxide reacting with silicate rocks, as happens today. We may presume then that carbon dioxide was present. There are also various iron oxides in the rocks, which from a chemical point of view could not have formed under Jupiter-like conditions, but equally could not exist if more than a trace of oxygen was present. We may take it that oxygen was no more than a trace gas at the time. Finally, we must assume that nitrogen was the main component of the air then, as today, because nitrogen is almost inert as a gas and cannot be generated in large amounts by life. No known chemical or biological process could have produced an atmosphere so rich in nitrogen, so it must have been there all along. Thus, the Earth's atmosphere, nearly 4 billion years ago, probably consisted mostly of nitrogen, as today, with some carbon dioxide and water vapour, and trace amounts of other gases, including oxygen. There was essentially no methane, no ammonia, and no hydrogen. These predictions, based on the composition of early rocks, are supported by a second line of evidence, which provides a clue to the origin of this early atmosphere. This is the rarity of inert, unreactive gases, particularly neon, in the Earth's atmosphere today. Neon is the seventh most abundant element in the universe. It was abundant in the clouds of dust and gas from which the Earth and the other planets of the solar system condensed. As an inert gas, neon is even more unreactive than nitrogen. If any of the Earth's original atmosphere had survived the meteorite bombardment, it should have contained about the same amount of neon as nitrogen. In fact, the ratio of neon to nitrogen is 1 to 60,000. If there ever had been a Jupiter-like atmosphere on Earth, then it must have been swept away during that first ferocious period of meteorite bombardment. Where, then, did our modern atmosphere come from? The answer seems to be volcanoes. As well as emitting sulphurous fumes, which would have precipitated in the rain, volcanic gases include nitrogen and carbon dioxide, in about the right balance, tiny amounts of neon, and almost no methane, ammonia, or oxygen. Where did the oxygen come from? There are only two possible sources of the oxygen in the air. By far the most important is photosynthesis, the process in which plants, algae, and cyanobacteria use the energy of sunlight captured by the green pigment chlorophyll to split water. The splitting of water releases oxygen, which is discharged into the atmosphere as a waste product, while the energy-rich compounds derived from the split by the absorption of light energy are used to bind carbon dioxide from the air and package it into the sugars, fats, proteins, and nucleic acids that make up organic matter. Photosynthesis therefore uses sunlight, water, and carbon dioxide to produce organic matter. It gives off oxygen as a waste product. If photosynthesis were the only living process on the planet, oxygen would continue to build up in the air until the plants used up all the available carbon dioxide. Then everything would grind to a halt. Clearly, this has not been the case. In fact, there are a number of processes that can consume oxygen, including reactions with minerals in the rocks and oceans and with volcanic gases. Today, however, almost all the oxygen produced by plants is used up by the respiration of animals, fungi, and bacteria, which use oxygen to burn up or oxidize the organic material they take in as food, extracting energy for the organism's use and releasing carbon dioxide back into the air. Plants, algae, and cyanobacteria also respire, using some of the oxygen released during photosynthesis to burn the carbohydrates produced by photosynthesis and extract the stored energy from them. Because animals, bacteria, and fungi all consume organic matter that comes from another organism, they can be classed together as consumers. By definition, consumers gain their energy through the respiration, the controlled burning, of the sugars, fats, and proteins made by the primary photosynthetic producers. The overall reaction of respiration, in which oxygen and sugars are consumed and the waste products carbon dioxide and water are produced, is almost exactly the opposite of photosynthesis and consumes essentially the same amount of oxygen that is being produced by photosynthesis. As well as using up oxygen, burning the food we eat regenerates the carbon dioxide needed for photosynthesis to continue. However much we may feel like parasites, the plants need us as much as we need them. If the consumers were to devour all the organic matter made by primary producers, then all the oxygen released into the air would be consumed by respiration. Perhaps surprisingly, this is very close to what actually happens. The oxygen released by the photosynthesizers is almost completely, 99.99%, used up by the animals, fungi, and bacteria which feed on the remains of the producers or on each other. The apparently trivial 0.01% discrepancy, however, is in fact responsible for all life as we know it. It represents the organic matter that is not burnt, but is instead buried under sediments. Over several billion years, This adds up to a vast amount of buried organic matter. If organic remains are buried rather than eaten, then the complete re-uptake of oxygen by consumers is prevented. For the chemically minded, the overall equation for photosynthesis can be given as CO2 plus H2O yields CH2O, organic carbon in the form of carbohydrate, plus O2. Respiration can be given as the reverse reaction. This means that for every molecule of CH2O, or its equivalent in other organic matter, that is buried and not burned up by respiration, one molecule of O2 is left in the air. The leftover oxygen accumulates in the atmosphere. Almost all our precious oxygen is derived from a 3 billion year mismatch between the amount of oxygen generated by the primary producers and the amount used up by the consumers. The vast amount of dead organic matter buried in the rocks dwarfs the total carbon content of the living world. The Yale University geochemist Robert Berner estimates that there is 26,000 times more carbon buried in the crust than is present in the entire living biosphere. Put another way, this means that the entire living world accounts for just 0.004% of the organic carbon currently present on or in the Earth. If all this organic matter reacted with oxygen, then there would be no oxygen left at all. If a mere 0.004% of total organic carbon, in other words, just the living biosphere, reacted with oxygen, then 99.996% of the atmospheric oxygen would be left over. Thus, even the most foolhardy destruction of world forests could hardly dint our oxygen supply, though in other respects such short-sighted idiocy is an unspeakable tragedy. Buried organic matter takes the form of coal, oil, and natural gas, as well as less obvious remains mixed with sediments and minerals such as iron pyrites or fool's gold. Ordinary sandstone rocks, which do not appear to have any trapped carbon at all, typically contain a few percent organic carbon by weight. Because these rocks are so abundant, they actually account for most of the organic carbon buried in the Earth's crust. Only a small proportion of buried matter is accessible in the form of fossil fuels. This means that even if we succeeded in burning all the coal, oil, and gas trapped in the Earth's crust, we would still only deplete a few percent of atmospheric oxygen. The original source of oxygen in the atmosphere was not biological photosynthesis, however, but a chemical equivalent. Few processes show more vividly the importance of the rate of a reaction and the difference that life can make. Solar energy, especially the ultraviolet rays, can split water to form hydrogen and oxygen without the aid of a biological catalyst. Hydrogen gas is light enough to escape the Earth's gravity. Oxygen, a much heavier gas, is retained in the atmosphere by gravity. On the early Earth, most of the oxygen formed in this way reacted with iron in the rocks and oceans, locking it permanently into crust. The net result was that water was lost, because after it had been split, the hydrogen seeped into space and the oxygen was consumed by the crust instead of accumulating in the air. Over billions of years, the loss of water through the effects of ultraviolet radiation is thought to have cost Mars and Venus their oceans. The Mars Global Surveyor, which has been orbiting the Red Planet since April 1999, has sent back detailed pictures of sedimentary rocks that NASA scientists say probably formed in lakes and shallow seas. Erosional channels suggesting the presence of flowing water on Mars sometime in the past were described long ago, but the new images provide the first solid evidence that oceans once existed on Mars. Whether these oceans drained away under the surface of the planet or evaporated into space, or both, is as yet unknown. Today, both are dry and sterile, their crusts oxidized and their atmospheres filled with carbon dioxide. Both planets oxidized slowly and never accumulated more than a trace of free oxygen in their atmospheres. Why did this happen on Mars and Venus, but not on Earth? The critical difference may have been the rate of oxygen formation. If oxygen is formed slowly, no faster than the rate at which new rocks, minerals, and gases are exposed by weathering and volcanic activity, then all this oxygen will be consumed by the crust instead of accumulating in the air. The crust will slowly oxidize, but oxygen will never accumulate in the air. Only if oxygen is generated faster than the rate at which new rocks and minerals are exposed can it begin to accumulate in the air. Life itself saved the Earth from the sterile fate of Mars and Venus. The injection of oxygen from photosynthesis overwhelmed the available exposed reactants in the Earth's crust and oceans, allowing free oxygen to accumulate in the atmosphere. Once present, the free oxygen stops the loss of water. The reason is that it reacts with most of the hydrogen split from water to regenerate water, so preserving the oceans on Earth. James Lovelock, father of the Gaia hypothesis and a rare scientific mind, estimates that today, with oxygen in the air, the rate of hydrogen lost to space is about 300,000 tons per year. This equates to an annual loss of nearly 3 million tons of water. Although this may sound alarming, Lovelock calculates that at this rate it would take 4.5 billion years to lose just 1% of the Earth's oceans. We can thank photosynthesis for this protection. If ever life existed on Mars or Venus, we can be sure that it never learnt the trick of photosynthesis. In a very real sense, our existence today is attributable to the early invention of photosynthesis on Earth and the rapid injection of oxygen into the atmosphere through the action of a biological catalyst. How life began on Earth is beyond the scope of this book. Interested listeners should turn to the writings of Paul Davies, Graham Cairns-Smith, and Freeman Dyson. Let us accept that life evolved in the oceans of an Earth shrouded in an atmosphere of nitrogen and carbon dioxide, but with as yet only trace amounts of oxygen. Photosynthesis probably evolved early. We will return in Chapter 7 to the theme of how and why this happened. For now, we wish to chart how life responded to the challenge of rising oxygen levels, as photosynthesis pumped out oxygen into the air and the oceans. Did oxygen pollution bring about an apocalyptic extinction, as proposed by Lynn Margulis and others, or did it stimulate evolutionary innovations? So long after the event, is there any evidence left to support either interpretation? The gauntlet was thrown down as long ago as the 1960s by Preston Cloud, one of the pioneers of geochemistry. Even after the large technological strides that the field has taken since then, his work and views still cast a long shadow today. Cloud argued that the major events of early evolution were coupled with changes in the oxygen content of the air. Each time oxygen levels rose, life responded with exuberance. Cloud himself set three criteria to prove this hypothesis. We need to know exactly how and when the oxygen levels changed. We need to show that the adaptations of life happened at exactly the same time. And we need good biological reasons for linking the change in oxygen levels to the evolutionary adaptation. Just how far Cloud's hypothesis is true in the light of new evidence is the focus of the next three chapters. To make our quest more manageable, we will split Earth's history into three unequal parts. First comes the Precambrian, that long and silent age before there were any visible fossils in the rocks, excepting a faltering experiment in multicellular life in the last few moments. Next comes the so-called Cambrian explosion, when multicellular life exploded into the fossil record like Athena from the head of Zeus, fully formed and wearing armour, shells in their case. Finally, the Phanerozoic arrives, our modern age of land plants, animals and fungi, when trilobites, ammonites, dinosaurs and mammals pursued each other in geologically swift succession. The conditions that enabled such an explosion of multicellular life were all set in the Precambrian period. We will deal with this period in Chapter 3, therefore, and with the Cambrian explosion and the Phanerozoic in Chapters 4 and 5, respectively. Chapter 3. Silence of the Aeons. 3 billion years of microbial evolution. It is next to impossible for us, with our historical perspective honed to decades or centuries, to conceive of the vast tract of time that ebbed away during the Precambrian era. We are dealing with a period that spanned 4 billion years, 9/10 of the total duration of the Earth. Imagine that we are rocketing backwards through time at a rate of 1 millennium per second. In 2 seconds, we will have returned to the time of Christ. In 10 seconds, to the birth of agriculture. In 30 minutes, we will see the first cave painters. And in less than 2 minutes, we will catch a glimpse of our ape-like ancestors shuffling across the African savannah. Rushing backwards, the catastrophe that wiped out the dinosaurs will unfold before our eyes in 18 hours' time. And in 4.5 days, we will have prime seats for the opening drama of multicellular life in the Cambrian explosion. Then we continue our journey in silence. In 44 days' time, we will have returned to the first mysterious stirrings of life, and in 53 days, the Earth will condense from a cloud of gas and dust. For 40 days and 40 nights, in our compressed timescale, the Earth was populated entirely by microscopic single-celled bacteria and simple algae. With no real fossil record to bridle the imagination, it is not surprising that most of the pioneering efforts to understand the early history of life were little better than speculation. How can we have any coherent idea today of biochemical changes taking place in microbes that left little trace in the rocks, or of the oxygen concentration in a fleeting atmosphere long gone? The answer is indeed written in the rocks, sometimes in microscopic fossils, and sometimes in the molecular ghosts of ancient geochemical cycles. More than this, the atavistic genes of modern organisms often betray their evolutionary roots. The script written in the genes is enigmatic, although obviously meaningful. Our only guide, a molecular Rosetta Stone, is the way in which the proteins encoded by the genes are used today. If a protein such as hemoglobin, the red pigment of red blood cells, is specifically designed to bind oxygen today, and we know from genetic sequences that some bacteria also have a gene for a similar protein, there is certainly a good possibility that our common ancestor had it too. If so, we can infer that they too used the hemoglobin to bind oxygen. If instead they used it for something else, the clue to what that was may still be hidden in the structure of the molecule. To understand the effect of oxygen on evolution, we need to trace 2 stories in the rocks and the genes: the evolution of the microbes themselves, and the timing and magnitude of the oxygen buildup in the air. Before we begin, however, we will do well to bury a hatchet in a particularly subversive double-headed ghoul. This is the common misapprehension that evolution necessarily tends towards greater complexity, and that microbes, being microscopic and without brains, are at the bottom of the evolutionary pile. So many evolutionary biologists have attacked the lay concept of evolution as a progression towards a higher plane, and to so little avail, that one begins to wonder whether there is a global conspiracy to thwart them. 2 cautionary tales should provide a clearer perspective on Precambrian evolution. The first challenges the assumption that evolution tends towards greater complexity, while the second argues that microbes are far from simple. In 1967, Sol Spiegelman, a molecular biologist at the University of Illinois, reported a series of experiments designed to establish the smallest unit that could evolve by natural selection. He took a simple virus that replicated itself using only a handful of genes, which consist of a string or sequence of 4,500 letters. The protein products of these genes subverted the molecular machinery of infected cells to produce new viral particles. Spiegelman wanted to see just how simple the viral life cycle could become if he provided the virus with all its raw materials in a test tube instead of a host cell with its complicated molecular machinery. He gave his virus the main enzyme necessary for it to complete its life cycle, and a free supply of all the basic building blocks needed for it to copy its genes. The results were spectacular. For a while, the virus replicated itself exactly, preserving its original gene sequence. After a period, however, a mutation caused part of one gene to be lost. Because this gene was only necessary for the virus to complete its normal life cycle in an infected cell and was not necessary in the test tube, the mutant virus could survive quite happily without it. More than happily, in fact. The new gene sequence was shorter than the old one, so the mutant virus could replicate itself faster than the non-mutant viruses. This faster rate of replication allowed the mutants to prevail over their competitors until they too were overtaken by a new mutant, an even slimmer-line virus, able to replicate itself still faster. In the end, Spiegelman produced a degenerate population of tiny gene fragments, which became known as Spiegelman's monsters. Each little monster was just 220 letters long. They could replicate at a furious speed in the test tube, but could not hope to survive in the outside world. The moral of the tale is simple. Evolution selects for beneficial adaptations to a particular environment, and the simplest, fastest, or most efficient solution will tend to win out, even if this means that excess baggage is jettisoned and organisms become less complicated. We now realize that many simple single-celled organisms, which we once thought were relics from a primitive age that had never evolved a complex lifestyle, have instead lost their ancient sophistication. We touched on fermentation in the last chapter. Far from being a simple energy-producing system that was later displaced by more efficient mechanisms involving oxygen, it seems that, as in the yeasts, fermentation is often a recent, in evolutionary terms, adaptation to oxygen-free environments, and such fermenters have actually lost their ancestors' ability to use oxygen. My second cautionary tale illustrates the metabolic sophistication of supposedly simple microbes. Humans and other large animals will quickly suffocate and die without oxygen because our bulk, a community of some 15 million million cells, precludes the use of any other type of respiration. As a result, we are rather limited in the biochemical reactions we can carry out, albeit very efficient at marshalling our limited resources. Some microbes, however, can live using oxygen to respire, but if deprived of air, will simply switch to another way of satisfying their energy requirements and continue without a glitch. The bacterium Thiosphera pantotropha is one such, and is about as far removed as we can get from our sense of an evolutionary pinnacle. It lives on feces. Originally isolated in 1983 from an effluent treatment plant, it applies an extraordinary virtuosity to the extraction of energy from sewage. When oxygen is present, it extracts energy from a wide range of organic and inorganic substrates by aerobic respiration. When conditions become anaerobic, however, it can extract energy from thiosulfate or sulfide using nitrogen oxides instead of oxygen. The only trick missing from this metabolic cabaret is an ability to ferment. Such biochemical versatility lends the bacterium great flexibility in lifestyle. It can switch from one energy-producing process to another in response to sudden chemical changes, which are brought about by the periodic injections of dissolved oxygen used to speed up the decomposition of effluent in treatment plants. Curiously, genetic analysis of a wide range of living organisms suggests that Leuca, the hypothetical bacterium proposed as the last universal common ancestor, the greatest grandmother of all living things in the world today, may have had a similar ability to switch between different types of metabolism nearly 4 billion years ago. Most of her descendants appear to have lost their illustrious ancestors' flexibility. We will return to this theme in Chapter 8. The Precambrian, then, was a time of spectacular metabolic innovation. Microbes learnt to harness the power of the sun, as well as the oxidizing power of oxygen, and to generate energy from an array of sulfur, nitrogen, and metal compounds. The chemistry of these life-giving reactions has sometimes left subtle traces, so-called carbon or sulfur signatures, in sedimentary rocks, and occasionally, not at all subtly, in the form of billions of tons of rocks. The metabolism of ancient microbes was directly or indirectly responsible for our most important reserves of iron, manganese, uranium, and gold, to say nothing of the gold prospector's false nugget, iron pyrites. These rocks and ores were not deposited continuously or synchronously, but at different times and under different environmental conditions. Their sequence has been carefully reconstructed through precise radioactive dating, and together the findings open a colourful window on oxygen and life in the formative years of our planet. The first signs of life in rocks are found in the same Greenland rocks that we discussed in Chapter 2, and take the form of an anomaly in the proportions of different carbon isotopes they contain. This important finding was reported in the journal Nature in 1996 by a NASA-funded doctoral student, Stephen Moisish, and his colleagues at the Scripps Institution of Oceanography at La Jolla in California. The interpretation of these carbon signatures in rocks is so important to our story that it is worth explaining what they are and why they are there. Not only do carbon isotopes preserve a record of the triumphs and tribulations of life, but their shifting proportions can permit surprisingly quantitative estimates of the changes in the atmospheric composition of the ancient Earth. There are several different atomic forms of carbon, as opposed to molecular forms such as diamond or graphite. These atomic variants are called isotopes. Each carbon isotope has 6 protons in the nucleus, giving them all an atomic number of 6. This means they are all carbon and all have exactly the same chemical properties. But the carbon isotopes differ in the number of neutrons in their nuclei, and so vary in their atomic weight. The more neutrons they have, the heavier the atoms. Carbon-12, for example, has 6 neutrons, giving it an atomic weight of 12, 6 protons and 6 neutrons, whereas carbon-14 has 8 neutrons, giving it an atomic weight of 14, 6 plus 8. Carbon-12 is by far the most abundant carbon isotope on Earth, accounting for 98.89% of the total, and has an honourable place in chemistry as the standard against which the relative weights of all other elements are measured. The carbon-12 nucleus is stable and does not decay. In contrast, carbon-14 is produced continuously in minute amounts, about 1 part in 10 to the 12, 1 part in a million million, in the upper atmosphere, through the bombardment of cosmic rays. The unstable carbon nuclei formed decay through radioactive emissions at a fixed rate. The half-life, the time taken for half the total mass to decompose, is exactly 5,570 years. This short time period, in geological terms, makes radiocarbon dating useful for determining the age and authenticity of prehistoric remains or historical documents, such as the Dead Sea Scrolls and the Turin Shroud. Carbon-14 is dispersed throughout the atmosphere and absorbed by living plants in photosynthesis, then eaten by animals, in proportion to its abundance in carbon dioxide. This abundance remains roughly constant because in the long term the rate of formation balances the rate of decay. When plants and animals die, however, the cessation of gas exchange or breathing means that their tissues are no longer in equilibrium with the atmosphere, so their carbon-14 content declines in proportion to the rate of radioactive decay. Older organic compounds therefore contain less carbon-14. Fascinating as it is, carbon-14 has no further place in our story. It is the other main isotope of carbon, carbon-13, that concerns us here. Unlike carbon-14, carbon-13 has a stable nucleus and does not decay. In this respect, it is similar to carbon-12. The total amount of carbon-13 in the Earth and its atmosphere is therefore constant, 1.11% of the total. This means that the overall ratio of carbon-12 to carbon-13 on or in the Earth is constant, 99.89 to 1.11. In other words, if we add up the total amount of carbon in plants, animals, fungi, and bacteria, and buried as coal, oil, and gas, and present in the air as carbon dioxide, and dissolved in the oceans and swamps as carbonates, and petrified as carbonate rocks, such as limestone, then we will find that the overall ratio of stable carbon isotopes is 99.89 to 1.11. Despite this fixed ratio, there are still some small but definite variations in the ratio of carbon-12 to carbon-13 in the carbon buried in the rocks. These variations are brought about by living things, and so far as we know, only by living things. The reason is that photosynthetic cells using carbon dioxide from the air or sea to make organic matter prefer to use carbon-12. This is because the lighter carbon-12 atoms have a slightly greater vibrational energy, which means that a smaller input of energy, activational energy, is needed for a reaction to take place. The reactions of the carbon-12 isotope are therefore catalyzed more quickly by enzymes than those of the heavier, less vibrational carbon-13 isotope. The faster rate at which carbon-12 bonds are cracked means that organic matter becomes enriched in carbon-12 relative to carbon-13. In fact, the ratio of carbon-12 to carbon-13 is skewed towards carbon-12 by an average of 2 or 3% compared with the unadulterated background ratio. When the remains of plants, algae or cyanobacteria are buried in sediments, their extra carbon-12 is buried with them. Because the buried organic matter is enriched in carbon-12, it is impoverished in carbon-13. This means that more carbon-13 is left behind as carbonates in the oceans or rocks, or as carbon dioxide in the air. This is called the principle of mass balance, which simply says that what is buried below the ground cannot be found above the ground. The implications of this elementary idea have a surprisingly long reach. Both carbon-12 and carbon-13 are incorporated into carbonate rocks, such as limestone, in a ratio that reflects their relative concentration in the oceans. As more carbon-12 is buried as part of organic matter, more carbon-13 is left behind in the oceans, and so the carbonate rocks have a relatively high content of carbon-13. Thus, biological activity is betrayed in two different ways: by an enrichment of carbon-12 in buried organic matter, such as coal, or by an enrichment of carbon-13 in carbonate rocks, such as limestone. Geological periods conducive to carbon burial, such as the Carboniferous, about 300 million years ago, with its huge low-lying swamps and massive coal seams, leave robust carbon-12 signatures in organic inclusions, such as coal in the rocks. The farther back in time we go, the harder it is to read carbon signatures, if only because less and less organic matter survives intact. Eventually, the samples shrink to the size of grains and require sophisticated equipment to read them. With this in mind, Stephen Moisish and colleagues set about studying the ancient Greenland rocks, determined to think small. Their approach brought swift rewards. They found minute carbon residues trapped inside grains of a calcium phosphate mineral called apatite. Apatite can be secreted by microorganisms, but can also crystallize inorganically from the oceans, so the association of carbon with apatite is, in itself, no more than suggestive of life. When the Scripps team examined the carbon isotope ratios, however, the results were startling. The carbon inclusions were enriched in carbon-12 by as much as 3% over the normal background ratio. As a leading geochemist, Heinrich Holland, remarked in the journal Science, "The most reasonable interpretation of the data is surely that life existed on Earth more than 3.85 billion years ago. Not only this, but life may even have discovered the trick of photosynthesis, which is, after all, the main source of carbon signatures today." Is this credible? Other pieces of evidence fit the same story. Moving forward a mere 300 million years to the 3.5 billion-year-old rocks in Warrawoona in Western Australia, we find microscopic fossils that resemble modern cyanobacteria. Throughout the Precambrian period, most cyanobacteria lived in communal structures called stromatolites, great domes of living rock which grew to heights of meters. A few living stromatolites are still found today in the right conditions, in Shark Bay in Western Australia, for example. Nearby, shapes resembling modern stromatolites are imprinted in rocks 3.5 billion years old. There is little evidence of geothermal activity, past or present, in these bays, so it seems likely that the microbes living in these ancient stromatolites gained their energy from photosynthesis, just as they do today. While none of these findings is conclusive on its own, when taken together, the carbon signatures, microfossils, and fossil stromatolites.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.